Tina offered me the honor to introduce who teaches me the course Introduction to Algebra to Cardinal Differential.
Let me thank the organizers for the possibility to spend some time in this fabulous place. And I would like to start with a word of apology. I felt a really elementary twist beginning of the course. If you get bored, please don't be bashful. Just tell me on the outside. So, algebra of Cardinal Differential operators. Well, to understand that, let's try to carefully analyze the notion of usual algebra. Is it working at all? Maybe then I should remove it. Is it working?
Yes. No. Yeah. Just don't move.
No, don't move the mic.
Of course, this...
well, we can just...
Everything gets documented. So the trait, of course, has analytic meaning to it, but we will be focused on algebra. So I'll give myself a reading. And whenever I say or write something like this, what I really mean is that the ring is an algebra of functions, regular functions formed usually by variety. Meaning that it's a quotient of a polynomial ring with complex coefficients containing many variables quotient by the radical idea. Much of what I will tell you doesn't require that, but the ultimate applications all are valid in this, under those assumptions. So whenever you have a ring, you have the algebra of all the relations. So let's carefully discuss what algebra structure. What algebra structure this object carries. So, well, of course, derivation means that this is a subset of all linear endomorphisms. Okay. This is an associative algebra and also a algebra with respect to the variety. And this is a subalgebra. So, with respect to the usual pattern. Second of all, it's an amorph. But the two structures are today. It's a real drop, but it's not an A to the algebra, namely the bracket of derivation and another derivation times an element of A, is evaluated by some kind of a version of a legend. So what will be important in the main part of the course is that we will be dealing with various versions patterns and extensions of such structure. It's important that this is a particular example of a real. For the moment, that's just a sentence. I will define those a little later. Next. The algebra of differential operators is plain. It's simply a subalgebra of the algebra of all. And most of now, this is regarded as an associative algebra, and this is an associative subalgebra generated by functions and the relations. And the example essentially now between calculus steel and if A is a polynomial ring, it's a free commutative algebra from which it follows at once that A derivation is uniquely determined by an arbitrary choice of the value in each of the generators. So this is a free A matrix with the basis D sub phi, by which I mean a partial derivative, which in this context may be regarded not so much as given by the famous limit of the change over run formula, but rather as a derivation that sends only one generator to one and the rest to two. We would like to do this not only over a fine manifold, but over an arbitrary variety, for which we need a shift version. So we would like to study how this notion interacts with the notion of localization. The answer is very simple. So now, pick a non-zero element of A and consider localization. It's a very simple and pleasing exercise to see that the algebra of derivation of a localization is a localization of the same as an A module. It's a very simple fact, but it's not always true. It's not true for any A, I'm saying. A should at least be finitely generated. The moment stop will show you that if A is a polynomial ring on infinitely many variables, then this is false. From which it follows that the algebra of differential operators also localizes nicely. In addition, you will notice that if there is an isomorphism, a ring, or rather, C algebra isomorphism, it induces canonically an isomorphism of derivations. And if you have any slightest doubts about it, you should think about the chain.
It's also true for homomorphism. Homomorphism induces homomorphism.
No, not any homomorphism. Vector fields map only in the case of it's a shift in, they say, a tautology. The formula involves the inverse of the Jacobian. You have to invert something. You know. If you have coordinates, I will talk about coordinates, then you know. dx, it would be dy dx. And this function must exist. So it's not true for an arbitrary isomorphism. You need both map and the inverse. I don't want to spend any time on this. I looked at some concrete examples. It's a problem with this mini course. It's kind of an interface of vertex algebra, vertex algebras and geometry. It never uses any deep algebra, algebraic geometry. It uses some. So I will be using something, but usually almost not explaining. So it follows that for any right variety, any algebraic variety carries shifts of those.
And now it's not necessarily affine.
Yes, algebraic. That's the point. So covered by affine, something covered by affine. So you have to glue and use that. There is shifts of if I denote the variety by x, then there will be shifts. Derivations in this context formula for vector fields and algebras of differential operators. In particular, if so you have shift of function, but it's a shift, so you have a ring for each open loop, and so you have, say, derivations over here. But then if you have V inside, V inside U given by this condition, where I fit an element of this ring, then of course you simply define the space of sections there to be a bit localized at that. Now let me look at the first non-trivial such example. This example will be like a golden thread for several of these lectures. So, CP1. But that's exactly the situation of a thing that's not not a fine. So it's covered by two copies of C. Let me call them C0 and C infinity. There are two coordinates there, and they are related on the intersection by, of course, this, and then the chain rule will give you the identification of the generator of modules of vector fields over intersection given by
So CP1 is a square of numbers up to constant factor. So C0 is for which the first coordinate is 0 or non-zero?
Yeah. So this is the set of pairs like this module, the relation indicated. Aside, let's say, well, I'm not sure. No, it's not x and y, because it's a and b. Sorry, it's outrageous. But so then c naught will be, say, a different from 0, and then x will be beyond b. Y there will be the other one. in general, how is it? I really mean it. Too slow? Do you want me to skip all of this and go like twisted differential operators?
No, very good.
All right, I already mentioned DDX several times. What's the meaning of DDX and algebraic geometry? Or put it differently, what is it that makes the situation when X is smooth special? For example, I'll skip any kind of definition of smoothness, but more or less by definition, smoothness means the existence of not so much as coordinates in the usual, you know, topological sense of the word, but of, as I sometimes say, coordinate system. So, if, more or less by definition, smoothness means this. For any point in X, there is a neighborhood, a fine neighborhood of X, such that there are functions defined on U and derivations over U, so that two properties hold. First of all, the whole algebra of the relations is a free OU module with psi 1 and psi n basis. And second, the value of psi I on X j is 1 if I equal j and 0 otherwise. It's not a deep fact, it's almost the definition of
free over all of you. Tx of u is free over all of you.
I want to skip. Is a free O X U module. So it's a free module. There is a basis of this module such that elements of this basis pick exactly one point. And then, of course, if this is the case, then when in algebraic geometry, one arrives at DDX I, or simply DDI, the meaning is, of course, SII in this situation. So, a collection of such functions, and then, of course, this condition is easy to see. If you wish, this is an exercise. This condition, in this exercise, determines psi 1 to psi n unique. I guess
you'll need both the string and. So it means that locally it's the algebra differential operators in the affine state.
No. I guess that's what you meant, but not quite. So what this means is that the algebra of differential operators, the algebra of sections over U is a polynomial extension of the algebra function. This is because that condition, di, fj equals delta ij, implies the basis of the theory. Is this what you meant?
But is a differential operator, is a prime space?
No, but this is not an integral function on an affine space. It's an integral function on an affine variety.
Ah.
That's the. I actually wanted to show
you. Okay, it's okay.
Here is an elementary example. Suppose it's X is an affine, is a curve in C2 given by this equation, the surface, so to say. Then, of course, X is, I don't know, U1. So there is a cover where U1 is, where X is non-zero. U2, what is non-zero? And then, they can both be equal to zero simultaneously. So this is a cover, and it's easy to see that over U1, X is non-zero, I guess, U divide. Is a without coordinate system over here too. X dx. But in either case, y or x isn't a coordinate in the way in a logical situation we understand the word coordinate. So for example, here, y is not an honest. Because x is not quite y. X, so it's an integer over y. X is 1 minus y squared. And it can take square roots in algebra.
But if you take algebra generally, then you get differential operator, usual differential operator.
I'm not sure. But in usual means while algebra. It's not quite while algebra. There is a and a slight extension. There is an x that's not in the while algebra, but its square is. That's what I meant. So it's a tau over C, but not quite C. That's what I meant. All right? Another important, very simple but important, absolutely fundamental observation is as follows. So this is a filtration. I don't want to write a definition of anything, but it's clearly by definition the union of those. It's an increasing filtration. The union of those gives you the electron by definition, and the filtration respects the product as well. Like this, one defines the graded.
The XC are the one defined above.
Okay.
XC. XC in this definition.
It's a vector.
It's the same as the one above. Like,
well, it's, there is no fix. Yeah, yeah, it's very I will tend to denote by Greek letters, vector field, and sometimes form, differential forms, and by Latin letters, elements of the ring. Is this your question?
I mean it's like this kind of dual of the coordinates.
No, it's not. No, it's not. Just vector fields. It's not coordinates. Okay. Coordinates exist only locally and highly non-canonical. So no. It's just elements of the algebra of the ring. Nothing special about it. So you define the graded object, which is an A module with a direct sum of successive quotients. And it's because of this condition, it's clear that this is scale, the multiplication on the algebra itself by choosing representative, define an algebra structure on this sum. This algebra associative, of course, commutative, that's because this is an element of degree 2, but the result actually falls down to degree 1, and therefore the algebra becomes commutative. And then there is a standard, absolutely fundamental trick, that you can use the non-commutativity of the original algebra to define a Poisson algebra structure on the graded one.
In the way, this algebra is somewhat symmetrical.
Yeah, yes, of course.
Over here.
Yes. So where you define, so for example, the Poisson bracket of, you don't even need vector six, so if you pick two differential algebras and consider the classes they represent, you have to do it carefully, I'll skip the detail. I'm sure we'll see many more examples like this, and I'm sure when Victor will be telling you about Poisson bracket solutions, things like that are likely to occur as well. So you, an element here is what? You pick an element of case, an element of case degree here. You pick an element of exactly case, which doesn't, an element that doesn't belong there. You take its class. You take another element, some other degree, take its class, and you define the bracket as the class of the original bracket, which, by the very definition, if this is KL, this must fall into K plus L minus 1, automatically. And so you take the class going down from the standard thing, and then you verify that the bracket is weak and it agrees with multiplication in exactly the way the original algebra derivations agree. It's a very simple exercise. You will notice that, just as Victor said, this is just a symmetric algebra over A of the algebra derivation. And of course, in the case when A is smooth, this is nothing but the algebra of functions on...
You mean girl of B?
Yes. So in particular, if... when variety is smooth, then what you get is the algebra of functions on the cotangent boundary. This, of course, carries the canonical Poisson structure, and it's even a symplectic variety. And of course, that definition of the another exercise. I will now show you slightly different point of view on.
And this way, I suppose it's true that this Poisson bracket is just a Kirilov Kostin bracket for the Lie algebra theory.
For example, if it's another, yeah, of course, yes. And this is something that will be even to an extent used. Yes. So here is a universal algebra type construction of the algebra D sub A. So D sub A is a can be described is an algebra generated I think of it as an Abelian group. So it's not just a collection of elements that generates, but rather the sum of such elements is described. But otherwise, it's another with these generators subject to relations. And the relations are all absolute vectors. Say, star means the product of, in the algebra, generated by those. So the product of two elements in A is stipulated to be the honest product. Likewise, the function and the derivation. And so it goes. The bracket of the vector fields is the bracket. And the bracket. So how about multiplying them in the opposite direction? Again, you have a little hesitation in writing something like this. F psi minus psi. F is, of course, psi evaluated on F. I could avoid writing down those annoying relations, because the algebra by itself is a subalgebra in some given algebra. But in other situations, we will get an algebra that's not acting anywhere by its definition, and so some relations will have to be imposed. All right, what all of this is good for? Again, as a prerequisite for the actual content of the course, let me, or rather, as a framework, let me talk a little bit about Leibniz and Bernstein. Localization. So, here is a classic example of how one relates a geometric, essentially, construction that I was talking about to a pure algebraic, linear algebra, involving representations. So I will again focus on the simplest possible, but still rather instructive and to an extent a cornerstone of simple algebra theory. An example of a circle. So we have 4 is over 6. So then there is a Lie negation. So the Lie algebra are such matrices that you see. traces. And I will need a specific and standard basis for that. So of course the graph is in H and H graph is either E or F gives you positive magnitude. So of course, SO2 acts on the plane, it's a fundamental representation, hence on lines in C2, and this is C equal 1 that has been briefly discussed. Whenever a group acts on a variety, the algebra maps into the algebra of globally defined vector fields. And this is the algebra morphism. I apologize for saying that, but those who are not too familiar with this are advised to verify that if you make choices, there aren't many of them. Essentially, the formulas for that map in local coordinate system, and there may be a discrepancy in what I'm about to write, and I'm not even sure. I hope you saw very little that perhaps these formulas will always be correct, but they will undoubtedly be always almost correct. Of course, it's easy to verify that these vector fields satisfy those relations, but it's exactly the vector fields that arise from that geometric definition.
It's in this chat here.
Yeah. It's those two, either one or another. Maybe up to a sign, there is not a morphic changing the sign, something like this. E goes to minus F cut, this is. So maybe it's like this, if instead of x you write y. But then in terms of x it will be the other way around with some, maybe it's all right. So one way or another, this is essentially correct. So hence, if you have a real algebra map, there arises a corresponding associative algebra map from the inverse of enveloping of a SO2. The algebra of globally defined differential operators. Question is this. Is this an isomorphism? The answer is no. But it is not for a specific reason. Again, those are not quite familiar with this and would like to play with this more will enjoy perhaps verifying that under this you have a formula, and so you can verify that the following mysterious element of the universal and enveloping algebra goes to zero.
But it's surjective. And it is surjective.
Say it again?
It's surjective.
Subjective.
it's a chip. I'll tell you the exact, I'll soon give you. Yes, it is a chip. It's even essentially an isomorphism, but I will tell you. The meaning of this is, of course, clear to anybody even superficially familiar with this. That's not just an album, that's the Casimir, you see? Universal envelope of the sort too. Has a center, and it's a famous result, whose feeling is it? In a sort of case, I don't know. So it's a polynomial album generated by this precise element known to everybody under the name of Casimir. So the standard goes to zero and nothing else. So the theorem, so you can, what, so the theorem says that the map I discussed above factors through the projection onto this algebra model the ideal generated by the center. I'll put zero, meaning it's a, so it's a standard notation, we'll see later on why. You can likewise quotient by the kernel of any central charge. In a simple character. So what I mean, of course, is the universal model, the ideal generator, the center.
Not quite. See, you want to exclude constants.
Excuse me?
You want to exclude constants from something.
Yes, I want to exclude.
So maybe you're
Z plus. Thank you. Yeah, of course. So the statement of the theorem is that this obvious map is an isomorphism. So this is the statement. Since we will be dealing with such things, and this is a course, I will allow myself to prove this. So, U of SLTN, this is really what Victor meant when he was talking about Kirillov constant. So it's an associated algebra, it's also a filter. The same way, so U S of 2, K is the span of the products of elements of S of 2, taken Eiffel products with I at most K. And the graded object arises. And it, of course, is that the content of its own correlation is given that the graded object is the smash of SL2. This filtration. So the map, U of SL2 into differential operators. See, this is also a filter, just as this algebra is, so is the space of sections. And so this map both are here. And this map, by definition, respects two equations. So we obtain a map of symmetric algebra. The map of the space of global sections of the corresponding graded algebra. In fact, not only of this, of course, is filtered. What I will need is this, really. So it's not S of S of two, but the corresponding grade. The ideal is homogeneous, so fading descends onto the closed.
But why center goes to zero?
Oh, that's
yeah.
Where I started.
Why?
It's a direct computation. It's just computation. Yeah, there are the four derivatives according to differential operator, and things cancel out.
But in general, you cannot do direct computation for any algebra.
That's why I focus on SL2. SL2, it's a wonderful theory. SL2 is the case when everything can be verified and almost ungraded.
So it's a non-trivial point.
Usually, yes, it's quite it's not very non-trivial, but yeah, it's something that really, you really have to understand what's going on. In this case, you just. One reason I'm doing this is that in the vertex algebra case, just computing, say, for a sort of hat is already an achievement. So let's do that's fine. It's supposed to be pedagogical. All right, now we need two facts. So this map. Is an isomorphism. And second, so what happened is I replaced what we wanted with this, and they're also isomorphic as vector space. There is an isomorphism of vector space.
But if it's for this tree, if for graded, it's isomorphism, then for filtered also.
Yes, but with the wrong, no, it's not obvious. It's not, this is not obvious. Because I'm going from the shape, of course. This is one shape and this is a different shape. Neither of those is obvious. What is true is if you have that one and two imply what I want, this is real obvious. It's like a statement that you have a map of filtered spaces that gives an isomorphism of graded spaces, then of course this map is an isomorphism. But none of the points here is exactly that. So, two along with one, of course, is this obvious argument. So, both two and one give that. So, I need to verify
but
these.
But two means just as much as vector space.
Yes. So two is an elementary exercise on elementary geometry. So what is this GRD CP bar? It's a symmetric algebra, so you have functions, then you have vector fields, then you have symmetric squares, and etc. So we will need a homology of such things. And of course, any student of graph geometry learns. So on CP1, so this is a an invertible tree. So this is a, because CP1 is one dimension. This is a line bound. On CP1, one has famous set shapes. N is an integer. So if you have two, so the definition of those is, if you have those two charges, then the gluing function is y to the n. So in particular, the vector fields, remember y squared appeared there, so this is O2. From that it follows immediately that the m symmetric power is nothing but O2 to the n. And you prove it by simply seeing that the generator over one chart is dx to the nth, over another is dy to the nth. And this thing equals, for dx you have y squared, so you will have y to the times n. Hence this result. The point of all of this is that the chronology of those shapes are very easy to compute. It's a very simple computation using the chip homology with respect to this covering. There are the covering consists of two fine subsets each equal to C, and the intersection is C star. And from that you immediately obtain you just compute, so the zero homology is 2 times n plus 1 dimensional. And the first homology is 0. So of course, this space will soon reappear as a as the irreducible isomorphism with high space to times n. That will also be important. But so, for example, you can compute that the sections here are, remember, for SL2, for example, U1, you could easily compute, you know, there was dx on the other chart, it's y squared dy. And so this is an element of the, this is actually globally, it's locally defined, but it extends uniquely to a globally defined vector. And the same, you multiply by x at your own risk, because x develops a forward infinity.
Wait, what is n in this answer?
Oh, n? So.
Ah, so you should put.
That's the n, yeah, n.
So the
symmetric power over. Yes.
There's no limit of CP, CP1 plus ON.
Yeah, it's still of me. S, N, tau, CP1, thank you.
Which is ON?
Hmm?
Which is ON?
O to that, yeah. For example, when N equals 1, people have DDS and then we multiply by F, but that's risky because F develops a pool. And this two here shows you that you can go up to power 2. So this is the basis for...
So this is O to N plus 1. O of 2N plus 1.
No, O of 2N.
2N.
The dimension is 10 plus. It's like high, this is highest weight? No. Well, this is half of the highest weight.
And if you take O of what, 2N plus 1?
Yeah, you will get, I think, yeah.
It is what?
You will get, well, O1, it's two dimensional, so yes. It's always, all, okay, always the case, but that's what I write is. It's always the case, of course. So what I'm saying is that this vanishing implies two, because there is the long black sequence of cohomology associated to the fluctuation. You see, you argue by induction. Yes, you think it's valid for k minus 1 and lower. So we will have 0, the space of global sections of this, the space of global sections of this, the space of global sections of this. Yeah, of this is CK1, SK. And then supposedly H1, etc., but H1 is 0 by induction. For N1, there is no difference. D itself is O plus T, and then that gives you the basis. And that's what we want. So this is already S. That's what we wanted by induction. So 2 is a very simple exercise, it's refreshing for algebraic people like myself, it's refreshing for many others perhaps. I'm testing your patience. As to 1, this is another. That's essentially purely a representation modulo what I told you. This is a fun representation theoretic argument, essentially particular case of the famous Hodgkin's theorem. Shall we make a break? So let's make a break, and after the break I'll tell you something about harmonic functions.
No, but we have to prove 1.
I
prove
1. No.
You prove 2.
No, 2, yeah. 1 is a particular case of Hodgkin's theorem. I will do it after the break. That's okay. What I said. One is about the. So let's return to where we started, to the map of universal envelope. Now we will regard this map as a map of SL2 modules. But not in the sense that SL2 acts on U as multiplication.
Yeah, I was wondering.
So,
I was
wondering. Where the action is not by multiplication, but rather by gravity. So I mean, x, for example, on the right, x of P, where P is an element of the universal enveloping, will be the bracket. And SL2 is global vector 2, so X there by integration, by drafting. And of course, by construction, it's quite clear that this is a morphism of SL2 modules with respect to this X. So what's the SL2 module structure of this? So this that we essentially discussed. So this space is a direct sum of global sections of those sheaves, and it's very easy to identify. I almost did that. It's very easy to understand. So this V by definition is an SL2 module, and it's easy to understand what that is. So I'll just remind you that, for each non-negative M, there is a unique M plus 1 dimensional irreducible representation of SL2. Let me denote that by L sub M. It is uniquely determined, for example, by a choice of a highest weight vector. That is to say, a P size that P is a term of 0 and H multiplies V7 by M. As we discussed, so for example, so O2 more or less by construction. And I erased this already, but remember I listed the global sections of that module, and it contains of it's spent by ddx, x ddx, x squared ddx, and that was the beginning of our discussion. That's how SL2 occurs. So this is SL2. So this is SL2 of the great change representation is of course L2. This is a particular case of what I would like to play. And the reason for that is also quite clear. So you will have an element there just as this module of rather space of global sections. This has ddx, and that has a meaning of d, that's a high space vector of weight 2. So this, for the same reason, will contain ddx to the power f. And the formulas that I erased will immediately show you that E, of course, fills it. E acts as ddx, s to h, it's minus to x ddx. And if you can, an elementary computation will give you 2 m ddx to the m. And of course, then classification of the irreducible representation of SL2 immediately. So there is a highest weight factor of highest weight to M. Therefore, this thing must have dimension at most 2 M plus 1. We know that the dimension is exactly 2 M plus 1. Hence, this is it. That's the right hand side. The fun, of course, is the left hand side. So what's the SL2 module structure of the corresponding universal enveloping algebra. And this is, there's a famous paper by Constant devoted to solving this problem. And in the case of SL2, Constant's argument can be made completely straightforward and elementary. I won't go into much detail, but I'll skip the steps, but I'll list the steps so that those interested in figuring out the details on their own. So the answer is this. U of SL2 it contains, as we discussed, the center. Yeah, so this polynomial. Tensor to the direct. Well, it's not equal. It's isomorphic.
It's a isomorphic.
Yes. So this is a trivial, of course, presentation. And then a module will come with multiplicities. So there will be a direct product of the following space, direct sum of L sub 2m. And varying from 1. No, I need a 0, right? I need at least one trivial. So I guess L0 will be identified to C1. So in other words, it's a direct sum of highest weight quadrant with even highest weight, and these multiplicities. It's even, all of this has a grading, and so this is even more precise than I wrote. But so this implies what? Yeah, the important thing is that where L sub to M is generated by E to the M. So this implies what?
Generated is a simple
note. Yeah. With respect to the graph. This implies 1 because where these go is easy to see, as we discussed, because the e to the n goes to exactly dx to the to times m by construction. Nothing here, so the restriction of the map appearing in 1 on this space is injected. The whole thing isn't, but it isn't for an obvious reason. This generator goes to zero. So upon one, what remains so is a direct sum of del, but that's exactly what that is. We just discussed that. This is right? So how does one prove constant results? So it's quite fun. So this is all about doing some partial differential equations. So
but this problem can be proved just by counting dimensions.
This? No, perhaps you're right. Perhaps it's even easier than I thought. Yeah. All right. Then I can skip the fun details. Yeah, you can. Yeah, there is a simpler. That's the advantage of having a cut in the room. Yeah. All right. So this is a. You just compare the dimensions. All right. So before I move on, I call this intersection Bernstein, Bernstein localization. So just if you what I'm about to say, won't really be used, but let me put this the discussion. So what was the fact that I discovered? There is this isomorphism. It's a pleasing result, but what's the point? The point is that this is an important step in a certain program. The fact that there is a morphism like this at all, in this particular case, is checked by simple calculations, and the very existence of this map, not necessarily it being an isomorphism, implies a functor from the category of U of SL2 modules at the vanished central character. So what are D modules? So if you have a sheaf of algebra, if you have an algebra, you can talk about a module. If you have a sheaf of algebra, you can talk about a sheaf of such. It's a sheaf of modules over a sheaf of modules over this now a sheaf of algebra. So they should be quasi coherent, and otherwise that's just that. A sheaf of an object there is a sheaf of modules over this sheaf of algebra. And the functor is obvious. You take M. How do you make this into a sheaf? You tensor M with this algebra over the associative algebra of a star. It acts here and we constructed the map there, therefore this makes sense. This is a vector space, so this is a sheaf, therefore this is obviously a sheaf. You also have a functor in the opposite direction. One we also use. Namely, if you have a D module, you can consider the space of global sections. Now this apparently is a module over the subject because the algebra maps into the algebra of global differential operators. In fact, this is a pair of adjoint functors, as is easy to see. The famous theorem of Bernstein-Davidson and Zelinsky-Shavara is that, well, perhaps this particular form of the theorem is only Bernstein-Davidson. I'm not quite sure, I don't want to offend anybody. An application of this kind of argument to the famous, the proof of the famous catalytic conjecture has been obtained in both papers. But this whole thing is typically called Bernstein-Davidson localization, and I'm not sure that we forgot the question. Anyway, the theorem is that these are mutual quasi inverses. In other words, the two categories are equivalent.
What does it mean, quasi inverse?
You can talk about inverse functors. So that's why I want, if you want, I can write inverses. I think this is a terminology, that's all. So what this means is that if you take a composition of the two functors, and there are two ways of doing this, the result is not necessarily an identity functor, but a functor isomorphic identity. And that's why I think people call this such pairs of functors quasi inverses. If you please. But I'm just saying that the two categories are equivalent, that's all there is. So what I my discussion, therefore, seems to be an extremely particular case of what I stated. So, for example, it's easy to see that so this functor is called localization. If you think about it, then it's the first theorem of algebraic geometry that a similar localization procedure gives you all quasi-coherent shifts on a fine scheme that are obtained in such a way. Hence the terminology. The simplest example is that localization of your vessel 2 is simply the algebra of differential operators. This is obvious. People who are interested may want to think about it and see that if M is U, of course, if you turn with U over U, then of course the U is a free thing, therefore it's just B. The functor in the opposite direction is the space of global sections. I should have written one. This, by the way, makes sense not necessarily for zero, but it will. And if I wrote like this, the result would be zero. It doesn't make sense to write it. It's a material anyway. We could rather simplistically consider that. Of course, this makes sense for any model, but I guess if the center of that character is different, we'll get zero. Perhaps this is still true. Like this. I guess it's true, but it's not important. What's important is that doing this in the opposite direction was exactly the subject of my explanation. So for this to be true, this must be isomorphic. And this is a non-trivial result. In fact, proof of this theorem in the case of SL2 is quite non-trivial, and the portion that I explained is an important part of it. So it's a fundamental thing. And it's true for an arbitrary flat variety. For an arbitrary flat variety, this fact becomes much more involved. All right, but this places immediately a question. So another example. So how about a reducible representation? Well, a central character picks a unique reducible representation. In this case, the reducible representation of central character 0 is, of course, C. And that will go to what? Can you guess? What's the localization of C? Functions. But of course, for representation theorists, they are all important. Can we localize an arbitrary irreducible representation? Well, not using. If you write L sub m here, you will get a zero. Central element here will give you, here it will give you zero, and here it will give you a non-zero number. Therefore, everything will get killed immediately. So we have to do something else. And this something else is also interesting and important, and not very different from what I've done. So to obtain localization of other representation, one has to do. They use not differential operators, but twisted differential.
So if you have a representation, say, of SL2, you call localization of it. Shift of modules.
Shift of modules? Shift of D modules.
Shift of D modules.
D X on the left, naturally. So this is like induction, and this I'm not sure, but nevertheless, this is
So trivial representation corresponds just to ship or CP1, and now you explain what corresponds to non-trivial.
Yes. So this is an exercise. In general, computing this thing is not very easy. Sometimes it is. Even for a cell phone. So let me start with the simplest possible example. Such things are, of course, well known before Bernstein appearance. So by definition, dx, differential operators, of course, are operators acting on function. What else can we do? Twisting this perhaps is not immediate, but kind of twisting a function is. Instead of function, you can consider the line bundle. Is a sheaf of algebras. This structure is not generalized, but OX is a module over itself, and this is what generalized. The line bundle is the same as OX, but only locally. The Gluin function can be non-trivial, but locally, this is undistinguishable. And if you have a line bundle, then you can consider differential operators, so differential operators acting on the line bundle.
Acting on section?
Yes, that's what acting on, not so much on the line bundle, but rather on the corresponding invertible sheaf. So on the sheaf of sections of the line bundle. What that means should be pretty clear even to those who have never really seen it. But here is an example. So take this famous O sub n, so O n. So what is it that I mean by differential operators acting on the sections of the sheaf? So there are two charts, C and C. And the space of sections on each is just functions. But to remember that this is not really functions, what it means is that we chose a localization. That's how invertible sheaves are defined, pick trivializations. But then you have to impose the the Gluin functions, and this being S being OM means that S not equals not S infinity. Rather, I'd like to be, S infinity. So, for example, in the case when S not is DDX, you can have Y squared DDY. And so it's clear, so when I say differential operators acting on OM, I mean on each operators that on each chart are those well algebras. On one and on another. Where perhaps I should rather write not so much DDX as not DX. Some operator, not to be interpreted as a action on a plant and the notation is just symbols. So the action of, so DDX is not really there. You will see the transformations are different. So the Lewin functions here are different, but whatever they are, they give you Lewin functions here. So what I want to say is that this is defined by identifying this over a chart with a function. That's what I've been talking about for a long time. So acting on a chart by this symbol is the usual one. Somewhat somewhat informally, what I want to say is that the action on a snot is easier, because I think of a snot as one. But what will this appraisal look in terms of one? So you just compute. You have to see how this thing acts on SNP. But what's S infinity? It's S naught times S to the n. And so you will have n x to the n minus 1. S naught. What does this mean? You see, now the DDY of S infinity for this reason is zero, and therefore you see that the transformation rule is this. It's minus y squared as nabla dy plus some plus minus and y. Three. So we just have to write this term in terms of S infinity. S naught is S infinity times y to the n, and this is y to the log. Minus n, and this is n. So n goes, and we only need, that's what I get, that's the correction. That arises thanks to the changed Lewin function. Make sense? All right. So what does this mean? Can we place this particular example, I mean D sub L, into a more general context? We can, and this is doing this is a good exercise. I lost it. Generally, you have twisted differential operators, or rather, algebras of twisted differential operators. I'm not sure what's a better way to pronounce it. So the usual differential operator started with T sub A, or perhaps better to think of K plus T sub A. That's where the discussion of differential operators begins. To get twisted ones, you have to start with a generalization of this. It is usually called car A algebraics. What's that?
It is generalization of this algebraic, which we can see.
Yes, yes. So again, I have a ring with the same reservation as before. So what's a Picardian algebraic? I will denote it by curl A. That's not a good notation. So this is as follows. It's a real algebra. And I listed some of such properties when I discussed the algebra of derivations. It's an A module. And there is an extra structure, one that allows to generalize. But these two were already present. So there are two maps, I and C. I is a map from E to solute A. And sigma is from A to derivation. This map is called M. And these data satisfy the following relation. So first of all, I and sigma fit in the following exact sequence. So you have B, I, A, sigma, derivations. So this sequence is exact. That's one. So I is a map of A modules. And sigma respects both the real structure and the A module structure. Remember, we discussed that. That, of course, is also a real algebra and an A module. So sigma has to be a map that respects both. Respect means really the bracket goes to bracket, and this is a morphism of A module. So it's a morphism of it's a morphism of the algebra, it's a morphism of A modules, and then remember the algebra structure and the A module structure, even for T sub A, they are compatible in a specific manner, kind of a Leibniz rule. So the purpose of sigma is to extend this dependence rule to this general, more general situation. So plus the following conditions. And if you bracket two elements, and for one, psi and eta are not elements of T, rather elements of, but not necessarily of, not necessarily functions. So you, of course, have one term later, as you would expect. And I'm using the bracket on curve A. But then, for TA, there was psi evaluated on A. Well, psi is not a vector field. So you make it into a vector field, and then graph A. So this is an analog of psi of A, theta. Okay. Is it too long? There are 10 minutes to go. Do you want me to continue, or is it? Or is everybody exhausted? Shall I?
So this sign it that we are living currently A.
So psi eta are elements of the curly A, then A is an element of not curly.
So do you understand correctly that for the usual algebra, A plus T A is a semi-direct sum? And but here you have more general situation. You have exact sequence, which can be less split.
You're right, but I will also assume that this, it splits. It's not a part of the definition. It will, if T sub A is free, then it automatically splits. And this is what I will be interested in. So the generalization is not about splitting. It's about the bracket. But the bracket in so. You will see, but the real difference between what I started with, simply A plus A, is that, maybe this is what you wanted to say, that this is a direct sum of, how to put it, A?
Of A mod.
It's a direct sum of the algebras. The bracket of vector fields is a vector field. My generalization is that Picardly algebraic is A plus TA, but T sub A is not a subalgebra. The bracket of two vectors, so to say, alleged vector fields, is a vector field plus perhaps a function. That's the generalization.
Yeah,
that's
okay.
That's what you meant. So, yeah. You were exactly right. So, of course, such things exist, and that's where all of this started. But the bracket of the vector field is a vector field, and in general, this is violated. You know, I should have perhaps, let me make a short intermezzo. So, we're headed towards twisted algebra of potential operator. So, in one sentence, an algebra of twisted differential operators is a field that A algebra such that the corresponding graded algebra is commutative. Hence, Boston. And isomorphic to the graded object associated to the usual algebra of differential operators as Boston algebra. So in other words, discussing twisted algebras of differential operators is a problem of quantization. We have this standard Poisson algebra, the knowledge of the symmetric algebra of derivation, the standard Poisson algebra. How can you quantize it? So the discussion I started is a more explicit construction of such.
So there are many quantities.
Yes, yes, and I will give you. Yeah, I will give you an answer. It's given by the second Ram cohomology group of the ring. So I will present.
The parameters with each.
Yes, I will present a complete classification of that. So remember, we have obtained the algebraic differential operator as some sort of universal enveloping algebra of an algebra of derivations. This was avoidable in that case, because by definition you can talk about such things as operators acting somewhere. And if you have something like this, curve A, this is not acting anywhere naturally. Therefore, you need, here you need the language of a universal enveloping algebra. And here is a precise definition derivation. Maybe, you know what, perhaps I should give it later. You know, I have like 3 minutes to go, and this really is something that one wants to start and have done from the beginning. So I'm now approaching the classification.
Audience is always happy when they actually. Audience is always happy when lecture is finished.
Okay. Let's try to keep audience happy.
Any questions?
Is this also called a Tia algebraoid?
I'm not sure about it. Perhaps this is slightly more general. I guess I'm not sure. I think algebra usually is defined for what principle vector bundles in a smooth situation. So it's very similar. I think it's more general. Is it true that IKEA algebraoids are local isomorphic to differential operators? I mean, oh, they can be much bigger. They are up. It's different. So for one thing, it's more particular. It deals with line bundles. Of course, you can do arbitrary vector bundles in the same sphere, and then you will have something somewhat different. But it's an obvious generalization. But I'm not sure. But I suspect that IKEA algebraoids are locally isomorphic to differential operators on a vector bundle. Is this true?
I'm not sure.
I think so. But if so, then it will be more general, because what I'm going to get in general isn't isomorphic to differential operators on a vector bundle.